Amen. God bless you. Good morning. Praise the Lord. You can be seated. I want to welcome those of you that are joining us online. A couple things before we get started. I'm going to have Pastor Latu come up. Really excited about this. Aloha.
Aloha.
Wait, go back. Hang on. Okay. Do this.
I hate it when that
happens. Oh, did I do that?
It's okay. It's all right. There. Just hang on that for a second.
Okay, I got it.
There. I'll just move this up. Okay. Nope, you did it again.
Here, I have a better idea.
A second.
I got it. Okay, let's just close in prayer. That's the end of the... Don't look. Don't look. You're not supposed to see this. It's the sermon. Don't look. Okay, here we go. All right, now you're good. I did this side. Let's try this side. Aloha.
Aloha.
Pastor JD and we here at Calvary Chapel Kaneohe, we're very excited. We're hosting an upcoming outreach. It was birthed in a small Bible study that God is blessing. The event will commence on Saturday, August 27th, here on the church grounds. It'll start at 12 noon and it'll end at 3 p.m. The name of this outreach is Rally for Jesus. The purpose of this is to get Jesus to people and people to Jesus. Amen. This is an opportunity for the body of Christ to show the world that Jesus is alive. Amen?
Amen.
We've been in contact with Keylight Radio, and so they're going to help promote this outreach. The event is also a good venue to give back to our community, as we're giving food packages to families, as well as care packages for the children. I understand that there might be a shave ice machine there. Pray that we'll have beautiful weather on that day. Amen.
Amen.
Included in these packages as well will be the most needed gift, a Bible. A prayer team will be present. They will connect with and minister the love of Jesus Christ to those who attend. We'll open the gates of the church and invite the community to come in. All will be welcome. There'll be volunteers who will hold signs. There'll be those who wave flags and banners. They'll be promoting the love of Jesus. And they'll be standing out on Kamehameha Highway fronting the church. There's a role for those who want to help. If you feel led to help and would like more information, please contact Tanya. Tanya, are you here? Why don't you stand? The email address is handsforhisharvest@gmail.com. Again, Tanya. The email address is handsforhisharvest@gmail.com. Hope to see you there, and God bless you.
All right, one more thing. Save the date of Thursday, August the 18th. Now, in lieu of our study through Jeremiah, which we have on Thursday nights, we're going to have a testimony night, powerful testimony of the power of parents praying for a prodigal. Actually, it is really looking forward to this. It's a week from this Thursday on the 18th, and we're going to have Mom, Dad, and Gabriel up here, and they're going to share this powerful testimony about never giving up on a wayward daughter or a prodigal son because he came out of the LGBTQ lifestyle. Yeah. So... that's going to be Thursday night, the 18th. That will be live streamed. And here's the thing, by the way. We usually start the teaching at 7:30, the worship at 7. We're going to get started right at 7. So right at 7 o'clock, it will be live streamed. And for those of you on YouTube and Facebook, you can actually begin watching at 7 p.m. on Thursday night. We're going to take the better part of an hour and a half. We're going to need all of that. In fact, we'll probably get you home about midnight. No. But anyway, really looking forward to that as well. Very excited about what God is doing. And key point, God is doing it. So there's no mistake about that. All right, James chapter 5. Almost done with this epistle. Not quite, though. So our text is verses 13 through 18 in chapter 5. I'll ask those of you that are able to stand. You can follow along as I read. If not, where you're seated is just fine. So we're going to pick it up. Wait, what happened here? We're going to pick it up in verse 13. James, by the Holy Spirit, is writing and says, is anyone among you in trouble? Let them pray. Is anyone happy? Let them sing songs of praise. Is anyone among you sick? Let them call for the elders of the church to pray over them and anoint them with oil in the name of the Lord. And the prayer offered in faith will make the sick person well. The Lord will raise them up. If they have sinned, they will be forgiven. Verse 16, therefore, confess your sins to each other and pray for each other so that you may be healed. The prayer of a righteous person is powerful and effective. Elijah, verse 17, was a human being even as we are. He prayed earnestly that it would not rain, and it did not rain on the land for 3.5 years. Again, verse 18, he prayed, and the heavens gave rain, and the earth produced its crops. Let's pray, if you would please join with me. Father in heaven, thank you. Lord, we, especially with this passage that we have before us, are keenly aware that unless the Holy Spirit gets and holds our attention, we're going to miss something so powerful and life-changing that you desire to minister to us. So Lord, please, will you do that? Will you keep anything away that would distract our minds away from what it is that you want to say? Will you speak clearly, Lord, in that still small voice of the Holy Spirit? And Lord, when you do, we want to not only hear, but take heed to your word as you do. So Lord, speak. Your servants are listening, we pray. In Jesus' name. Amen and amen. You can be seated. Thank you. So what I want to talk with you about today is not just the power of prayer. I mean, that's almost become cliche, right? There's power in prayer. I want to talk about why prayer is so powerful. So much so that, and I want you to think about this, along with the Word of God and salvation, prayer is actually our most valuable and powerful possession. Do you believe that? Amen. If you were asked, what is the most valuable possession you have, what would your answer be? What is the most powerful tool you have, or as we're going to talk about, weapon. Oh, you guys got weapons? Yeah. Prayer. Now, I realize that this is quite a way to begin by way of introduction, but here's the truth. There's a reason that prayer is so powerful. And actually, there are five. in the text that I found before us today, five reasons as to why it is. Okay, we agree prayer is powerful. There's power in prayer, but let's see why. Why is prayer so powerful? Well, James, by the Holy Spirit, is going to answer that for us, beginning in the first part of verse 13. And I realize this may sound like a firm grasp of the obvious, but prayer is so powerful when it comes to bringing about God's help. Now, we know that God is omnipotent, all-powerful, right? So when we pray, we are accessing Almighty God, who is all-powerful. We are connecting ourselves to the power source, if I can say it like that. You'll forgive the illustration, but it's kind of interesting. You know, we have chargeable devices when the power gets low, right? So we charge up the batteries or whatever that device is and get it to 100%, but then it just keeps going back down again. So what do? We charge it back up again. How about this? Why don't you leave it plugged in? Amen. I know. If you got a better illustration, I'm more than willing to hear about it. When we pray, we are plugging into the most powerful power source available to us. Because He's all powerful. And isn't it true that when we need help, we need a lot of help, we go to somebody that is able to help us. We're not going to go to someone who is unable or does not possess that which we need in our time of need and help. So we go to the one who is able, more than able. I need strength. I need help. I need power. I'm here. I'm available. All you have to do is ask. Let me say it like this. We have unfettered access. We never get voicemail. We have unfettered access to an almighty God who is all-powerful and has everything we need whenever we need help. Are you kidding me? And we don't ask Him for help, and that's available to us? What has prayer become? How diminished and devalued and depreciated has prayer become in the life of a Christian when we knowingly have access to this power source, but don't? You know, in Ephesians 6, this is a passage of Scripture that we're very familiar with. We affectionately refer to it as the spiritual armor. Put on the whole armor of God. We wrestle not against. Wrestle's an important word. That's a correct translation because that's kind of a game changer. It changes the complexion of spiritual warfare. Because when you say battle, well, it's a battle. When you say wrestle, that's full body. Every muscle in your body is engaged in wrestling. For those of you that know about wrestling, when you wrestle not against people, but you're wrestling against, and Paul lists and delineates four entities in the spiritual realm that have different rankings. And he goes on, and we know it well. Maybe even it could be argued we know this too well. We know about the helmet of salvation. We know about the, which protects the mind, by the way. We know about the breastplate of righteousness, which protects the heart. We know about the shoes of the gospel of peace, the readiness. We know about the shield of faith that is above all locked tongue and groove, wherewith to extinguish the flaming arrows of the evil one. We know about the sword of the Spirit, the only offensive weapon in the armor. And we also know about the belt of truth, which, by the way, holds everything together. Think about that. Truth, the sword was in the belt. The breastplate connected to the belt. The shoes all the way up. The shield had a connection to the belt. Everything, the belt held everything together. No wonder it's the belt of truth. That's what holds everything together. So we know about the armor very well. Again, maybe too well. But here's what we don't often talk about when it comes to the spiritual armor. How do you put it on? How do you use it? Prayer. I find it very interesting that the Apostle Paul, after using this metaphor of this spiritual armor, would go on to say, and pray continually, always. That's how you put the armor on. I mean, think about it like this. Here I am. I've got the armor on. I got my sword. But I'm not using it. I'm just standing there. When I don't pray, I am not using that which has been given to me. My armor, my weaponry. That's how we put the armor on. That's how we use the armor. Prayer. Prayer. Especially when we're under attack. Spiritual attack. But how is it and why is it that here we have this access to an all-powerful God who has given us an open offer to come to Him anytime about anything? And He's there at the ready, and He's even taken it further and promised us that if you come to me anytime about anything and you ask me for anything and it brings the Father glory, you got it. And James has just got done talking about you have not because you ask not. So, again, let's get back to this, because I think if we're honest with ourselves, I don't think there's a one of us here, myself included, by the way, that has not been in a situation where I've needed help and I've not gone to Him for help. Here is my God, my Lord, my Savior, my King of Kings, my Lord of Lords, who loves me so much, and He's just waiting there. Just come to me and ask me. I'll help you. But no, we call someone else up, ask them for help. And the Lord's like, just ask me. May I suggest that sometimes God will allow a situation into our lives if for no other reason than to get us to come to Him for help. For those of you that were with us in our study verse by verse through Hebrews 4:16, this is a life verse, a favorite for many. The writer of Hebrews says, let us then approach God's throne of grace with confidence. Now I want you to hang on to that word confidence. so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help us in our time of need. I think we might have the answer kind of woven into the fabric of this verse here. And I'll explain. Could it be that we don't go to the Lord in prayer and ask for help because we don't have this confidence that He'll help us? We don't have this, for lack of a better way of saying it, sanctified strength or holy boldness. Some of your translations actually render it as boldly coming before the throne, because you have access now. There's nothing separating you. That veil has been torn. You don't have to wait till that one day of the year, Yom Kippur. No, you have unfettered access. You can come in anytime. Call upon me anytime. Come to me confidently. Now, this is not self-confidence. This is a faith and confidence that, hey, I can go to the Lord and I can be assured and confident of this one truth. In my time of need, I need help. I am confident that God is going to help me. And here's another thing. We've talked about this before. It has been life-changing for me personally. And I hope it's an encouragement to you, especially when it comes to prayer. God will always answer our prayers the same exact way we would answer our own prayers if we knew what He knew. Because not only is He all-powerful, He's also all-knowing. He knows the end from the beginning. So sometimes we'll go to God and we'll ask, and then God doesn't answer our prayer, our way, in our time, in our color, and our preferences. Because we went to the preferences in the settings and we set our preferences, and God didn't respond to those preferences. Why? Oh, if you only knew. I sometimes imagine, this is just the way I think, pray for me. I know they have clinical terms for this, but I just picture the Lord just going, you don't want me to answer that prayer. I mean, I want you to come to me, but if you were privy to what I know is coming, you would not be praying that way. And that's why we say things like, I'm so thankful for the prayers God has answered, but I'm also very thankful for the prayers that God did not answer, because had He answered that prayer that way, it would have been potentially catastrophic, and God knows that. And the timing thing is a thing too, isn't it? We get impatient because God may be waiting in His time to answer that prayer. And truth be made known, you don't want Him answering that prayer prematurely. Because in waiting, and we have, again, there's so many cliches, God's delays are not God's denials. But I think about Isaiah 30, verse 18. The Lord will wait to be gracious unto you. It's the grace of God. The timing of God. His timing is always perfect. He's never late, but He's never early either. So when we go to Him, we have this boldness, this confidence that He's going to help us, but He's going to do it in His way and in His time for His glory. But just take it to Him. I think about that timeless hymn of old, what a friend we have in Jesus. Oh, what needless pain we bear, all because we do not carry everything to Him in prayer. Man. Here's God just saying, come to me. I will help you. I will help you. I have everything you need in your time of need. Just ask me. I want to help you. I love you so much. It brings me such great joy and delight to be able to help you. Why don't you come to me for help? Well, this brings us to the second part of verse 13, when we find our second reason as to why prayer is so powerful. And I'll explain this one, but it's simply God's presence. Now, stay with me on this. James says, first of all, and I'm glad he starts off like this, because he had me at, is any among you in trouble, let him pray. Okay, well, that's me. I guess I better pray. But then he goes on to say, is any among you happy and joyful? Well, praise the Lord. Wait a minute. Did you know that praising the Lord is prayers of praise? When we sing, we're actually praying in our praises to the Lord. Now, you have to understand that, because it's germane to why it is that prayer is so powerful. See, God inhabits the praises of his people. This is, by the way, why it is that, I'll just use Thursday night as an example. You know, you come home from work, you want to get to Bible study, but man, has it been a rough day. And you get home, and then you make the fatal mistake of eating, which you shouldn't do, because, you know, I mean, the drowsiness just starts, you know, and then you sit down, and that was your next mistake, and it's kind of like, I'm so tired and full. I go just watch online. I'm not talking about anybody. I'm not looking at anybody. I'm just saying. And by the way, this is the local congregation we're talking about here. And then you get up and you get in the car and you get to church. And then Capone comes up and he starts leading worship. You're like, oh. It changes everything. I mean, and you're going, wow, I'm so glad I came. Oh, interesting. Maybe that was the enemy. Oh, come on. Isn't that why it is? See, Satan knows Scripture better than you and I do. And Satan knows all too well the power of prayer, because he knows it's the deciding factor. That's why whenever you set your foot to pray, you set aside time to pray, all H-E double hockey sticks breaks out. Was that okay if I said it like that? I could use toothpicks if you want. You get the point? I mean, the phone rings, the kids fight, you know, something happens. That's the enemy. You get drowsy. That's the enemy. He doesn't want you to go to church and praise and worship the Lord, because he knows that's the deciding factor, that God inhabits the praises of his people. If the presence of the Lord is here in this church when we praise him. This is Psalm 22:3. But thou art holy, O thou that inhabits the praises of Israel. So watch this. Psalm 16:11. You will show me the path of life. In your presence is fullness of joy. At your right hand are pleasures forevermore. So let me see if I got this straight. Watch how this works. So I praise the Lord. He inhabits the praises of his people. And then when his presence is there, that's when I have the fullness of joy. Well, no wonder the enemy doesn't want me to pray or praise, because he knows that the Lord is going to fill me up. I mean, physically, everything changes. Tired? I'm not... Before... my eyes, my eyelids, you know, the toothpick thing and the yawning and the, and then I get here, I mean, the hands are lifted up and I'm not yawning anymore. I'm praising the Lord all the evermore. It actually affects you physically, physiologically, neurologically. Did you know, I don't want to get too far into this, I'm learning a lot. One of the things I'm learning is that I have a lot to learn, but one of the things I'm learning is that when you sing and praise the Lord, you're actually using both sides of your brain. Now, I need all the help I can get when it comes to my brain and the brain usage. But do you know, and these are not Christians we're talking about doing the research, these are secular researchers have found that there is within our brains and minds almost this pre-wiring for music. Like we were created to worship. We have to worship. It's not a question of, are we going to worship? The question is, what or whom are we going to worship? Because we were created to worship. And that's why it is that when you drag yourself here, and you're really tired, you've had a really long day, and you start praising the Lord, and you're just thinking to yourself, and I almost didn't come. And I mean, the presence of the Lord is here in this place, and fullness of joy ensues. And it changes your whole being. It changes how you feel, how you think. Well, I want to keep moving. There's so much. Maybe this should have been a two-part teaching, but we'll try to cram it into one. I'll get you out of here about two. We'll be okay. Let's talk about God's healing, verse 14. Now, here, James provides us with what to do when someone is in need of healing. And it's actually specific, and we do this as a church. We'll anoint with oil the head. Now, back in this day, they would pour. Man, if I did that, I'd probably get slapped. But they would actually pour the oil on the person. I mean, it would be dripping down their beards, and of course, assuming they have a beard, but you would anoint them with oil, a symbol of the Holy Spirit, by the way. There's nothing magical about the oil. Man, I need to get me some of that there oil. No. It's a symbol of the Holy Spirit. And you anoint them with oil, and then you lay hands on them, and then you pray for them. And as we're going to see in the next verse, the prayer offered in faith will heal the sick. That's how powerful prayer is. Prayer is so powerful that it can bring about God's healing on the sick. Now we have a problem here, and I think you know where I'm going with this, because this has given way, sadly, to many a false teaching about if you just have enough faith, you'll be healed. Well, you're not healed, you must not have enough faith. We know it as the word faith, or as one sarcastically described it, name it, claim it, blab it, grab it. It's a false teaching. God wants everybody healed. Oh, really? Yeah, we just have enough faith. And they go to this verse to bolster their case. Well, that's the problem, because throughout Scripture there are many accounts of those with faith, I mean men and women of faith, that were not healed. Chief of whom was the Apostle Paul, and I want to draw your attention to 2 Corinthians chapter 12. You know this well, but I want to point something out here. Beginning in verse 7, the Apostle Paul is writing by the Holy Spirit and says, because of the surpassing greatness of the revelations, for this reason, to keep me from exalting myself. Some of your translations render it exceedingly exalted. There was given me, this was a gift, a thorn in the flesh. How's that a gift? A messenger of Satan to torment me. No, thank you. I don't want that gift. To keep me from exalting myself. Concerning this, I implored the Lord three times that it might leave me. He prayed and he pleaded with God. And what was the Lord's response? Come on, Paul. You can do better than that. Just have enough faith. I'll heal you. Yeah. Sorry, that was too much. No, that was not the Lord's response. Verse 9, and he said to me, my grace is sufficient for you. For power is perfected in weakness. Most gladly, therefore, Paul writing, I will rather boast about my weaknesses so that the power of Christ may dwell in me. Therefore, I am well content with weaknesses. Listen to this list. Weaknesses, with insults, with distresses, with persecutions, with difficulties. Are you as convicted as I am? For Christ's sake, for when I am weak, then I am strong. Okay, so what's your point, Pastor? My point is that if anyone had faith, it would have been the Apostle Paul, right? Are we okay with that? You in agreement with that? Well, Paul's afflicted, tormented. And, oh, by the way, we don't know what this thorn was, and stop trying to figure it out. I mean, Bible, there's no shortage of commentators pontificating and speculating about the possibilities of a thorn being thus and such. Stop! Don't you think that God, if he wanted us to know the specificity, would have inspired Paul to be more specific? Paul, what was it? Here's why it's not. Because if we knew what it was and it wasn't something that we struggle with, we would dismiss this. Oh, I don't struggle with that. What does the rest of the chapter say? No, by leaving it generic and not having it be specific, we give the Holy Spirit elbow room to fill in the blank. Because I would venture to say there's not one of us here or even watching online that doesn't have a thorn in our side. And we've asked God, God, please. Some of you right now are thinking, it's a person. It's my boss. Ah, God. And he doesn't. Why? Because that's where the power is. See, this is so powerful. If I remove it, it's game over. You're going to get puffed up, full of yourself, and proud. You're going to exceedingly become exalted. You're going to exalt yourself and leave me with no other choice but to humble you, because God humbles the exalted and he exalts the humble. Well, now wait a minute. Why would Paul be prone to be exceedingly exalted? Oh, 14 years prior, Paul doesn't even utter a word about it. And then when he finally does, it's almost like they forced him to, and he does so reluctantly, he refers to this event in the third person. He's talking about himself in the third person. I know of a man that was caught up to heaven and was shown, I mean, And because of that revelation, to keep me from not getting, I would have totally done that. I would have written books. I would have went on a speaking tour. I would have been so full of myself. But God's like, no, I'm going to protect you from this pride that will destroy you. So, Paul, you don't want me removing this from you. Yeah, but it torments me. But Paul resolves it and says, okay, I'm good with it now. In fact, I'm going to go from praying that God would remove it to praying, God, don't remove it. Because if you remove it, oh my goodness. So this is what is keeping me humbly dependent upon you. You're allowing this. It's tormenting me daily. A messenger from Satan, no less. Given to me by God. What a gift. Well, now I know it's a gift. This is a gift. And I need it. And please don't take it out. Because it's in this weakness, in this trial, in this struggle, in this difficulty, this situation, and you know what it is in your life, that you've been perhaps praying about for years, and God just, it just seems like your prayers are bouncing off the ceiling. Again, God's going to answer your prayers the same exact way that you would answer your own prayers if you knew what he knew. And he knows that if he were to resolve that situation, move that neighbor, kill that boss, get him out of there. Yeah, I'm sorry. Just remove the thorn. Whatever that thorn is, you fill in the blank. God knows. No, Paul, you don't want me to. That's where your source of power is, because it's in that torment, in that weakness, that you're accessing my grace. And the power is perfected in your struggle because of that thorn. Man, you almost want to ask for another thorn. Okay, don't push it. That's too much. We got another gnarly one here in verses 15 and 16, and it has to do with God's forgiveness. Now here again, we find a well-known passage of Scripture that has been the source of many a false teaching within the body of Christ. It's almost like roommates with, if you just have enough faith, God will heal you. What I'm speaking of are those deceived, having believed that the reason for their sickness is due to some unconfessed sin in their lives. Now, that's not to say, and let me hasten to say, that while the consequences of our sin can lead to sickness and disease, you cannot categorically assign one sickness to one sin. This is, again, another one of those go-to verses for false teachings, that the reason you're sick is because there's sin in your life. True story, I trust the Holy Spirit's prompting me to share this for someone's edification. My wife and I, took us 10 years to have children. We were diagnosed with what they called unexplained infertility, which basically means your infertility is unexplained. Thank you so much for that. How much do I owe you? So, of course, all the recommendations you need to adopt, or you know, might want to try this, or you know, we had some options. And so we would go to church, and all of our friends, this is 10 years now, our first 10 years of marriage. This year we'll have been married 34 years. Oh, I'm so sorry, I hesitated. Good thing my wife's not in this service. But 34 years, our first 10 years of marriage, no children. Oh, we would get pregnant and we would lose the baby in the pregnancy. Miscarriage, ectopic one time. We'd go to church, all of our friends, I mean, they're having twins and kids, and I mean new strollers, and they're buying minivans, and they're pulling up parking next to us like, nee, 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 nee. And it didn't help when one brother in Christ, I actually knew this guy really well, he not only told me that the reason why you don't have children and are unable to have children is because of sin in your life, because he was a childhood friend, he actually went as far as pointing out what the specific sin was in my life. Oh, that was, yeah, just this guy, get thee behind me, Satan. Thanks a lot, bro. What are friends for? And I would be disingenuous at best, dishonest at worst, if I didn't confess that it hit me hard and it hurt me bad. So I'm confessing everything. Lord, I'm sorry about that candy bar I stole when I was 4 years old. And I am going back into my life. It took years, but I didn't even cover everything. And so, but then the Lord just began to minister to me. No, it's not because of that. That's not why. There's an account in John's Gospel, chapter 9. Begin reading in verse 1. Now, as Jesus passed by, he saw a man who was blind from birth. And his disciples asked him, saying, Rabbi, who sinned? This man or his parents that he was born blind? This is bad theology. And if you're sitting here or watching online and you think this way, it stops right here and right now. Based on the answer that Jesus gives. Neither. How about that? Neither. This is not because of sin. Neither this man nor his parents sinned. I'm not going to get into the whole generational curses false teaching. Oh, wow, maybe I need to now with that response. I mean, it's right there in the commandments, Exodus 20. Have you read that carefully? He visits the iniquity, and that's their go-to verse. Oh, you're under a generational curse. Your great-grandfather was... Well, there could have been something there, but the Lord visits the iniquity of the children unto the third generation to show mercy to them. Not to curse them. You're going to pay for grandpa's sins. The sins of the father. No. I'm sorry, I went way off on that one. But no, there's no generational. Could you imagine? Jesus on the cross. It is finished. Comma. Except for generational curses. That's still an issue. You'll have to deal with that one. No. Hey, listen, our parents, maybe they were in some stuff and it messed us up. And yeah, there is iniquity there, but the Lord visits us to show us mercy. Amen. So you're suffering, you're sick. It's not because there's unconfessed sin in your life. It's neither. Well, then why was he born blind? Oh, I'm so glad you asked. It was so that the works of God should be revealed in him. He was born this way for such a time as this, so I could heal him. That's why. Not because of sin. Not his sin or his parents' sin. Well, wait a minute, Pastor. What about those accounts in the Bible where Jesus heals them, but instead of saying, rise up and walk, he says, your sins are forgiven. But think about the guy that they lowered into the roof of a full house in a basket, and Jesus heals him, but he says to him, your sins are forgiven. And here's the guys that probably let him down in the basket going, no, that's the wrong one. We need him to be healed. And then he says, your sins are forgiven. Wait, we went to all this work. We lowered him down through the roof. I think they owed that homeowner a new roof. But he says, and then they challenge him on it, and his response is, what is it easier for me to say your sins are forgiven or rise up and walk? In other words, it was because of sin. So there are occasions where sickness and disease are a direct result of sin. And we find one such account in John's Gospel, chapter 5. There's this man who's been afflicted for 38 years. And he's superstitiously waiting by the pool of Bethsaida. That's the Arabic Bethesda. Those of you that have been to Israel with us, we went to this site. There was a superstition that if you could somehow get into the water when the waters were stirring up, you would be healed. So this guy was into all kinds of weird superstitious stuff. And on this one particular feast day, Jesus walks by and sees him lying there, and he asks him, and I get a kick out of this. He basically asks him, do you want to be healed? Oh, do I want to be healed? Well, here's his answer. Sir, I have no man to put me into the pool when the water is stirred up. But while I am coming, another steps down before me. Jesus' response is, well, what do you want me to do? Throw you in so you can get healed? No. He says to him, get up, pick up your mat, your pallet, and walk. And he immediately was healed. Now, you get to verse 14, and Jesus finds him in the temple, and he's telling everybody. And they're querying him, who did this to you? Who did this to you, right? You got to love the religious leaders, right? And he said, look, there was this man that healed me. And Jesus happens upon him and sees him in the temple, and he says this to him. I want you to listen very carefully. Behold, you have become well. You're healed. Do not sin anymore so that nothing worse happens to you. The implication being, the reason you were so sick was because of your sin. He's not saying, be sinless. No, don't sin that sin anymore. Similar to the woman at the well, where he tells her, go and sin no more. Not the woman at the well, the woman caught in the act of adultery. And he says to her, go and sin that sin no more. Listen, there's no such thing as being sinless this side of glory. But here's what the Holy Spirit does indwelling us. It's not that we're sinless, we sin less. Did you catch that? I know it's a play on words, but that's part of the sanctifying, regenerating process of the indwelling and the empowering of the Holy Spirit. Well, I wanted to save as much time as possible. I didn't do as good of a job as I wanted to because this requires some time, this last one, number 5, in verses 17 and 18. And it has to do with prayer being so powerful that it can bring about God's miracles. Now, James here, once again, draws from an Old Testament example. This time, he brings up Elijah. One of my favorite men of God. I know I say that about every man of God in the Bible, but I can't wait to meet Elijah. I mean, this guy, you get to kind of know his personality a little bit from the accounts in Scripture. And you know that after that contest with the prophets of Baal, and then he has, we'll call it a crisis of faith, I guess, and he runs, and Jezebel's got a hit out on his life, and he's hiding in a cave, and the Lord appears to him, but not in the fire or the earthquake or the wind, but in the still small voice, and asks him, what are you doing? Just like that. He said it just like that too. Elijah, what are you doing here? He's like, there's nobody. They've all bent their knees. And he's like, Elijah, I got 7,000 just like you that back in Jerusalem that I haven't bent the knee to Baal. Anyway, that I went off on that. But he brings up this account of when Elijah prayed and the rains were stopped. Then he prayed again. You got 3.5 years of drought. Everything's dying. Everyone is dying. He prays again, and then it starts to rain. Okay, well, what's the big deal? I mean, this is Elijah we're talking about. Okay, I would close right now, except for this interesting detail tucked tightly into verse 17. I mean, we could close right now. We could all go home, except for what James says in verse 17, when he points out that Elijah is just like you and me. Oh, what do you mean? Well, if you're anything like me, and I suspect that you are, thank you for laughing on that, by the way. Isn't it true that when we read about Elijah and all of these mighty men and women of God, well, of course, it's Elijah. He, not only was he like you and me, he might have been worse. In other words, don't dismiss the miracles of God under the banner of, well, of course, because that was Elijah. No, that could have been you. And it can't still be you. Because Elijah is just like you. There's no difference between you and... I'm sorry if I'm yelling. Pastor, what do you mean? You yell all the time. But he was just a guy. He put his pants on the same way that we do, guys. Of course, they didn't have pants like we do now, but you get the point. He was just like us. He had doubts and problems and issues and issues. I'm not even going to go with that one. You already know about that. We all have issues. But I mean, he was a man just like us. So the point is that Elijah accessed that which we ourselves, like him, still have access to. Prayer.
Yeah, but God's going to, that's Elijah. He's going to answer Elijah's prayer. I mean, after all, this is Elijah.
Well, how about this?
This is Bob.
Okay, that didn't work too well.
He's an ordinary guy. Well, what's so extraordinary? Prayer. Prayer takes an ordinary Elijah, JD, Bob, whatever, and does the extraordinary. Prayer. That's how powerful it is.
I want to leave you with, and I'm going to include myself in this because I can just be as prone to sloppy agape as anyone else when it comes to this, but it's a challenge of sorts. And I want to pose this in the form of a question. When was the last time you asked God to do something just incredibly unbelievable? Like something only He could do. You know, sometimes we pray small prayers to a big God. I love the illustration. I heard it many, many years ago. It's always stuck with me. But it really does drive home the point. You know, here's God.
Almighty God, all-powerful God in heavens, creator of the heavens and the earth and the sea and all that in them is. He flung those stars. He knows every single one of them. He's not only counted them, we could never count them. He actually named them. And he remembers their name, unlike us. And he's waiting. All right, JD's going to pray. Gabriel, Michael, get over here. JD's going to pray. Come on, let's go. You ready? We're ready, all right. Whatever he asks, I don't care how outlandish it is, how big it is, we're going to do it. If it brings me glory, you guys get down there and make it happen. Here he comes. You ready? Shh, everybody quiet. Heavenly hush. Here I come.
Father in heaven, bless this food to our bodies and
okay, false alarm. You guys go back. I'll let you know next time. Here! Yeah! That's why I love that illustration. You get it, right? Here I am. I'm praying. I mean, there's nothing wrong with praying for a parking spot at Costco Evile, but nothing is impossible for the Lord, right? Somewhere at least close where I don't have to like park Eva Beach to get there, shuttle anyway. But when was the last time that you asked God for a miracle? I mean, it's like God just waiting on standby. Just ask me. In fact, he wants to. He's waiting to do it. God, this is impossible. Did you say impossible? Ooh, 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 ooh. I'm the God of the impossible. Watch me now. Well, everything's drying up. It needs to rain. Is your name Elijah? Because unless you're Elijah, I can't do it. No, it's just me, JD. Oh, okay. Do you have enough faith? No, it's not that either. Do you have unconfessed sin? No, it's not that either. Now, when was the last time you asked God for a miracle? God, I need a miracle. Well, I happen to be in that business. I happen to be in that line of work. I'm a God of miracles. Let me take it one step further, and then we'll close. What is it in your life right now, that situation, that set of circumstances that is so complex, it is so impossible, it's so hard, it's so painful, and the Lord knows, and you need a miracle. What would change if you, like Elijah, simply accessed the same power source that he had? What would change? What would change? What, you think God doesn't want to do it? Well, I've not been very good. You know, it's been a while since I've been in the Word. No. Doesn't work that way. Doesn't work that way. But see, the enemy has deceived us into thinking that we have to merit the miracle. No. Elijah was a sinner, by the way. I don't hope that didn't ruin anybody's, you know, afternoon, but he was a sinner, just like you and me. And yet, God did this all because he prayed. That's how powerful prayer is. Kapono, come on up. Why don't you stand up? We'll close in prayer. I hope. And again, I'll include myself. I hope that we will see prayer differently. Forgive us, Lord, for not accessing this thing we call prayer. Forgive us, Lord, for somehow just thinking, well, God's not going to do that for me.
Lord, I thank you that you answer our prayers, not because of who we are or how good we are, but because of who you are and how good you are. So, Lord, I just pray for anyone that might be just the enemy's just really done a number on them. Kept them from your throne of grace. I pray that today would be the new beginning of a powerful prayer life and a changed life because of it. Lord, thank you for prayer, and thank you for the power of prayer. In Jesus' name, amen.